happy today to have Scott Bartolini and Stosh Durbacz from Fujifilm with us. We are going to talk about their new projector, the FP-Z8000 and the FP-Z5000, which preceded it. And I got to tell you guys, I'm very excited to just share this projector with our viewers because, you know, I sit here and I look at all the new stuff that comes out. And obviously, you know, we've seen things evolve. We've gone from lamps to laser. We've gotten more brightness out of smaller packages, but it is extremely rare to see something come about that actually is a brand new development that we've just never seen before. So this is really a revolutionary product, and be great to show people what's really special about it. So, you know, the main thing, obviously, you only have to take one quick look at the projector to know that it is special because the lens is what stands out immediately. So let's go ahead and talk about that first and the different types of configurations you can do with it. What was it that made Fujifilm develop this? What kind of niche were you expecting to fill?
Well, I think, you know, Fuji's got a long history of making projection lenses in the background. So supporting all the projector vendors with their optics. We've done the ultra wides and all kinds of different lenses for those guys. Through the product development cycle, the R&D departments are always trying to find niches where they can really leverage their expertise. And from an optics perspective, that's a place of strength within the Fuji family of companies. So in looking at that market, they really were trying to find something that didn't exist in filling a need. So with this real cool lens optical system built into these projectors, they're really enabling integrators to deploy projection in areas where projection wasn't previously possible. With the ultra short throw, the big lens shift within there, and then the rotating and snorkeling of that lens really opens up a whole bunch of creative uses for this and projection generally.
Right. So how many different positions can you actually get out of that lens?
I feel free to answer that. So with the Z5000, we actually had 22 different variations, and that was either in the horizontal position or the vertical. And with the Z8000, you can actually do 12 positioning. And we'll get into more details about why we reduced the amount later into this discussion. But it was just really just for stability reasons and just feedback that we've gotten from our customers in the mm-hmm. past. So.
And is there anything special about, other than the fact that obviously you can get all these orientations out of it, is there anything special about the construction of the lens that sort of makes it stand out and superior to other products?
Well, a lot of that is really not only in the construction of the lens, but also in the coatings on that lens. So mm-hmm. enabling the light to pass through and reducing any flares or reflections within there. We also deploy aspheric elements. And that really helps reduce the total amount of glass required to enable that optical path, creating smaller, lighter weight alternatives. So you know those kinds of things are always being considered in the development side, trying to make things smaller, lighter weight, easier to handle, and a little more affordable. So a lot of that is the secret sauce, those coatings and the aspherics within that optical path.
Yeah, I noticed in some of the materials I was looking at. So those optical coatings, because obviously it's a very complex lens, you're sending light through quite a number of elements. So the potential for light loss, I imagine, can be pretty significant. Those coatings basically help more light get through. Is that what they're for?
Yeah, absolutely. So generally, when light passes through a piece of glass, it enters the glass and then exits the glass. And on every entry and exit, there's an opportunity for light to be reflected, therefore reducing the total amount of light getting through. The coatings help pass as much of that light through as possible. So there's always going to be some minimal reflection, but with that, with the new modern coatings, most of that light passes through. You minimize that. So in doing that, you'll see that even when we have to spec the brightness output of the projector, We're speccing that at what the actual output is and not what the light engine will do. So,
right.
You know, that's something even to be considered when we're looking at this, you know, in that Z8000 projector, it's a 10,000 lumen light source, but we spec it at 8,000 because that's what's coming out the front. with this fixed ultra wide angle lens, you know, there is more glass, there are mirrors in that path. So we are losing some light on the way through, which you would see even when deploying an optional ultra wide angle lens in a competing projector. So yeah, that these modern coatings really help minimize that roll off.
Yeah. One of the things that I noticed about the lens when I was reading about it is that, you know, I deal with a lot of the sort of home theater UST projectors. I've reviewed a few of those, and they use the standard mirror optics. And, you know, one of the things that I've found is that it's virtually impossible, even at 100-inch image size, to really, really get a good, crisp, undistorted image out at the far corners of the screen, you know, particularly the top corners as you get away from the lens. They just start to stretch out the image and you lose focus. But this projector seems to be able to maintain focus right out to the edges of the corners. What's the secret there to get that done? And I noticed also, I should point out, there's two focus buttons for the remote control, which I've never seen before on any projector.
And you're right with that, Rob. So what we designed and what we were trying to go with here is that we had a whole area focus button, which is that first focus button that you'd see on the remote, as well as the focus two, which will really hone in on those edges and just make sure that your image is as crisp as it can be. Obviously, there's going to be a little bit of distortion, but we try to mitigate that as much as possible. And we think that that's a really nice feature to have on this projector, especially when you're displaying in such large areas, as you're saying.
Sure. Sure.
Yeah, and I think that's really a compliment to the you know, our optics design philosophies. When we look at a lot of the other, in terms of the corner sharpness, I guess is where I'm going with that. You know, if we look at our offerings in digital cinema and in broadcast, it's important to provide a flat field of view relative to focus to the cinematographer or to the producer in sports, and that's always been part of our design philosophy. So that certainly doesn't change here. That's something that we do in all of our optical designs.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit too about you know, the size of, in particular, the Z8000. I should point out also, by the way, these are both DLP projectors, right? Single blue laser DLP projectors?
Yes.
Right. So the size of the FP-Z8000 is unusually compact for an 8,000 lumen laser projector. Is it the lens that allows that to happen? Is it other things that are going on to basically give you such a compact form factor for that?
I think there's some efficiencies just in creating a one-piece unit relative to the lens being fused in into the projector and that whole optical path being set the way it is, as opposed to being able needing to allow for optional lenses swapping in and out. Everything gets a little bit bigger, heavier as a result of that, so that you can allow for a whole variety of optical solutions. So really providing that turnkey system restricts some of the flexibility in terms of being able to use optional lenses. But conversely, it enables a much smaller, lighter weight package. So, you know, these are all trade-offs in the design process, and we need to consider. And our feeling was having that small, lightweight alternative for the marketplace was valuable.
I would imagine a form factor like that is going to be extremely attractive, particularly to the rental and staging people, because this is such a flexible projector at such a high output.
For sure, rentals and staging and also for installations, you know, in a lot of places you don't want to see this big projector, so being able to tuck it away in a corner and have that lens pivot around and then use that optical shift, and you know, we can be projecting somewhere where we're not casting shadows, where we have the ability to hide the projector, and it doesn't become a focal point at all. It's the images, it's the beautiful pictures, it's the art, you know, whatever it is that's being projected can be the point of focus, and you don't have this big cage and projector in the way.
Right. So the ability to kind of get it out of the way and avoid the shadows is obviously an important part of it. Yeah. I mean, what are some of the use cases that you've seen for this? And we can get into some of the case studies if you guys have some details on some of those. But, you know, where do you expect these things to really get used?
So we have had a lot of different applications so far with the Z5000. We've had them in very famous installations such as Tokyo Tower over in Japan, as well as UFO by Frank Frank in Osaka, Japan. A lot of international involvement as well as some here stateside as well. But with the Z8000, seeing that's a fresh new item, we haven't had too many installations yet, but we started getting a lot of inquiries just from what we've seen. And we could see this definitely in museums, retail, other installations as well. If Stosh, you wanted to add on to that?
Yeah, for sure. And I think where the power of this system is really going to be evident is in existing installations. You know, if you have a big air conditioning unit in the way, you can't really move that, but you want to display your content on a wall and behind it. And that's what we saw at Tokyo Tower. You know, it was in an existing welcome reception where they wanted to wrap around the video, but it was difficult to do that based on the things in the ceiling. So with the Z5000 at that time, they were able to deploy that. In Portugal at Porto Legends, it was the same kind of thing. They had 38 of these things deployed in this, wow, this historic building. Well, they can't be moving walls and things around in a historic building. So it enabled them to get their content wrapping around all the walls in a way that was non-destructive to the environment. So, you know, we're real excited with the 8000, as Scott mentioned. That one's brand new. We're super stoked to see as we come out of all these COVID lockdowns, where the integration teams can find creative places to deploy these stuff. You know, we certainly have some examples, but we're excited to be wowed by their creativity and to see where it goes.
Sure. Well, you know, and talking about some of the differences between the Z5000 and the Z8000. And I know there's a number of enhancements aside from just the lumen output, but just talking about the brightness there, you know, you go from 5,000 to 8,000. In some ways, that's almost a more significant jump than, say, 8,000 to 10,000, because it opens up a lot of new opportunities to get into ambient light environments. Is that part of what you were thinking there?
Absolutely. That's exactly what we were thinking, because as we do really like the Z5000, we thought we were stepping our game up quite a bit from going to 5,000 to 8,000 lumens. And it's just as you said, Rob, we were looking for situations where ambient light, we heard our customer feedback, and we wanted to just be able to get into those types of installations that do have what we're aiming for. Like in museums, you're going to have some ambient light in there. In retail stores, you're going to have ambient light in those areas as well. So it's kind of just... we developed it for those cases in particular. Absolutely.
Yeah.
The teams in Japan really are responsive to the feedback of the marketplace. So any of the improvements you see from the 5,000 to the 8,000 are a result of that feedback. They're always listening and looking to improve on the product and make it more usable for everyone out there.
Okay. And let's, so resolution, you went from a 1080p panel to a WXGA, right? So, That's a 16 by 10 aspect ratio. Was that something that was also seemed to be in demand in these commercial environments?
We just thought having a higher resolution would definitely be more sustainable in those types of environments. And we just wanted to kind of push that out in that way.
Mm-hmm. And you also improved the color to some degree, right? So there's been a boost of the gamut or the color space, as well as some changes in basically the white point. People were asking for more accurate color.
That's 100% correct. And we really wanted to just give our customers the best color quality that we could. And we worked with our Tokyo staff extensively to make sure that our color was in the right proportion that it should be.
Yeah, the good news for Fujifilm is we have an 85-year history of color science from our motion picture, still film days. So certainly the appreciation and the expertise within the color palette is entrenched in the Fuji mindset, and certainly not only from the light source and the panel, but also through the coatings. You know, being able to pass all those light wavelengths through is important. If your coating doesn't pass all that light back or forward through the lens in projection, as opposed to exposition lenses, then those wavelengths don't get presented. So there's multiple facets to that the color science within an optical system.
Yeah, that makes sense. And you know, you really pointed out a very important thing, which is that although the Fujifilm name is new to the projection industry, obviously anybody who knows who knows photography and optics is very, very familiar with the long history of the company. And it is interesting to see what that depth of expertise has sort of brought here in this.
Yeah, we are that same Fuji. And really, it's a testament to the leadership in Japan to see how effectively they've taken that those core expertise in nanotechnology and binding and color science in light transmittance and found new opportunities to leverage that expertise and diversified over time. So this is just another example of that.
Sure, sure. All right, so let's talk about some of the other upgrades that were made from the 5000 to the 8000. You know, I know that there was some warping and blending facilities put in. There's a few things. You guys want to go through some of those?
Sure.
So the warping and edge blending, we did add that in because we figured that we wanted to give our customers kind of just a full service opportunity, not to have to go through another third party or whatever it is. But we wanted to give them a system that they could download in their place that you can actually go on our website right now and download software. Wouldn't be useful unless you have the Z8000. But if you wanted to go into there and download and just look at the software, it is available online at any time. And right. we really just wanted to give a full service kind of a scenario. And we've seen it in action and is very intuitive.
Yeah, you can certainly see, you know, how this projector would get used, certainly in a lot of edge blending situations. Where it would be helpful to have that software facility. Does the 5000 have that ability, or is that something as well? Has it been added, or is it something that's exclusive to the 8000?
It's something that's currently exclusive to the 8000, but you still can go through a third-party software for the Z5000 to be able to achieve those things that you are looking for, yes.
Mm-hmm. And I know as well that there's been some changes made to the terminals in the back, right? So there's a few more inputs that weren't available on the 5000.
So that's correct. So we've added a few different features. We have an audio in and out, USB one in, SDI in, HDMI in, which accepts 4K, but it comes out as a UXGA. Display port in, HT-based T, which is a big add-on that we really thought was important for this field. LAN, HDMI 2, which is self-explanatory. USB 2, and our main power. Yeah.
Wow. So
we've got some different functions in there.
Absolutely. HD-based T is critically important for a lot of these long runs. So, yeah.
One of the nice, I guess, user-friendly, there's a few upgrades to the projector that were done. Things like three IR receiver points on the projector, so a little more flexible once it's installed to be able to set it up and adjust it with the remote. Also, you'll note that on the Z5000, you need to be powered up to release that lens and rotate it, move it around. There certainly was some feedback from the market from that perspective. So on the 8000, you are able to manually release that lens and move it without power, which is a big deal.
Oh, yeah, I can see that. Sure.
Yeah.
And just going off of that, like just the improvements to user-friendly kind of changes. On top of that, originally it was very difficult to pick up the Z5000 because there was no space in between where the actual projector sat and the platform that it was on. So we actually put like miniature handles on the bottom of these projectors so it's easy to lift. And there's little grooves in there too, so you can pick it up and transport it with ease as well.
And that's one of the differences you'll see, that there essentially is a plate on the bottom of the Z8000. Which is what limits the number of lens positions. But what that does is provide some stability and rigidity to the whole unit. So although the lens can't rotate the full 180 degrees that you see the Z5000 do, you have a little more robustness in the unit and some better durability as a result of that. So, mm-hmm. So that's one of the reasons for that change.
Gotcha.
Exactly. And it also adds to it makes it much easier to mount as well, and is much sturdier because of that.
It certainly does. It certainly does integrate into the Chief system of mounting. So there are the universal plates from Chief that will mount to both projectors and enable you to get into whatever configuration you need to be for your unique application.
Right. And the projector is relatively quiet, isn't it? I mean, for an 8,000 lumen projector, what is it rated about 40 dB?
At in eco mode, it's rated at 40 dB, and then like in normal function, it's about 43 dB. But you know the difference between the decibel level between 43 and 40. It's very significant.
It's actually a halving of the procedure.
Exactly.
Every 3 dB. That was a nice upgrade moving to the 8000. They were able to make it a little bit quieter as well, significantly quieter. So that's a fantastic upgrade there.
And that's just airflow design, basically. Changes in the airflow design, right?
Yes, that's 100% accurate. And we have two intake valves with the Z8000 and one exhaust vent. And because of that, just to let people know, if you want to mount this in a vertical orientation, you need to actually have it mounted. You need to have it like on a mounted plate to be able to put it in that vertical installation, because the intake valve is on the bottom as well as the side, and the exhaust vent is on the other side. So with all this airflow coming in, you need to have kind of a space in between there. It's about 15 inches of space for any type of installation you'd be looking to do. But because of that, the airflow is much much quieter than it normally would be. And it's also just a little bit sturdier just because of that as well.
Yeah. Hey, you know, can you guys talk a little bit about the lens memory functions? Because I know that there is some ability for the projector to either return to existing spaces or existing lens positions, but describe how that works and what you can do with it.
So what's great about the Z8000 in the lens memory function, so whenever you may be trying to adjust or figure out exactly where you want to put a display that you're trying to put together, we actually have four presets. So if you move it into any type of function, change the shift ratio that you have on that area, and then move it to another function, if you go back to that function that you just edited, it will actually go directly to the place that you just had previously. And we put that in place for people that are going to be on the go or have to change an installation from here to there, and we just wanted to have that functionality. So if they didn't like a certain preset, or if they wanted to play with the type of space or the orientation that it was in, that we had a different feature available. And a big improvement as well compared to the Z5000 is there's the ability to flip the image. So in the past, you were kind of just given what it was, but now you can actually flip the image opposite to what it was, so it will fit a scenario whichever way you'd like.
Right. So similar to being able to mirror an image for a rear projection or a front projection type of scenario. Yeah. Gotcha. And tell me a little bit about the lens shift, because both the 5000 and the 8000 have exceptionally wide lens shift capabilities. So that also adds to the flexibility.
Absolutely. And the lens shift range for the Z8000 is 70 vertical and 35 horizontal. It's one of the biggest class leaders in the shift range. And with the Z5000, I believe it's 80 and 35. You would have to quote me on that. Mm-hmm.
And the reason for the difference there is it is the same optical lens. It is the same lens on both units. So with the bigger UXGA sensor chip in the 8000, you'll see there's slightly less shift as a result of that. So it's the same lens with a bigger chip, therefore just a little bit less shift.
And is the 8000 now shipping or on its way?
This is shipping and this is now available. Yes, correct. So we have these readily available, and if you want to reach out to either of us, we'd be more than happy to respond.
And
We have sample units online now out of the headquarter warehouse in Jersey. Mm-hmm. So they're on the ground. We're excited to get them in people's hands and work with people as soon as they're ready. So we're ready to go.
And tell me quickly before we break off here, what's the deal with the simulator? Because it seems like you guys have put some special software online to help people figure out how to use these projectors.
Well, because the lens design is so unique and there's really nothing like it out there, the teams at Fuji have put together the simulator. So from our website, you can easily get to the simulator and you can plot out your unique application and confirm that the Z series projectors can in fact enable that projection. So between the ultra wide and the lens shift, you can play around within that simulator and see what's possible in terms of projecting with the Fujifilm Z series.
Great. Okay, well, I want to thank both of you guys for taking the time today, and I know that our viewers at the Expo are going to be very excited to hear all about this projector and learn more. Wish you the best of luck with driving a new type of product into the market now.
Thank you so much. Yeah, we look forward to meeting with everyone at the Expo, and thank you so much, Rob, for your time. Greatly appreciate it.
Yes, all right.
Thank you very much, Rob.
Sounds good, guys. Take care.
Thanks.